Hi, I'm Robert Jeffress, pastor of First Baptist Church in Dallas. We are so excited to have you join us on the iCampus today for a time of inspiring worship and biblical teaching. You are part of a vast online community gathered from all over the world. We consider you a part of our First Baptist Church family, and we hope you feel a part of what God is doing in and through First Baptist Dallas. No matter where you are, we hope and pray that this is a time you will grow in your relationship with God and others as we worship our Savior together. Welcome to worship.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship at First Baptist Dallas today. We welcome guests and iCampus viewers. Church, could we stand together? The word of the Lord says that in His presence, there is fullness of joy. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. Come on, let's sing.
We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who is.
Yeah.
worship our great and glorious God and King today. Great worship, church. You may be seated. And we do welcome each and every one of you to worship here at First Baptist Dallas today. And we do welcome the guests joining us here today in the room as well as on our iCampus. Guests, we have a very special gift for your coming today. It's our pastor's brand new devotional, Not All Roads Lead to Heaven, 100 daily readings about our only hope for eternal life. Guest, as you came in this morning, you received a worship guide, and you're going to find enclosed this welcome card. Please take the time to fill this out. You can also scan the QR code, and at the conclusion of the service, take your completed card with you. Right outside these worship center doors, you're going to find our welcome center. Our staff will be waiting there for you. You'll exchange your completed card for your devotional today, and we'll be happy to answer any questions you have about our church. We look forward to meeting you. Now, guest, if you can't make it to the Welcome Center, we also have some boxes on your way out. Just place your completed card in one of those boxes, and we'll mail your gift to you. And it is so good to see each and every one of you in the room. And the iCampus viewers, you will see a link on the bottom of your screen, and you can access your welcome gift that way. Well, we have so many exciting upcoming events here in the life of our church. So let's all take a moment now and look together at the screen.
Good morning, church. Here are a few upcoming events. Come back tonight at 5:30 p.m. for a special interview with For King and Country and Rebecca St. James. Plus, stay for the viewing of their new movie, Unsung Hero, an incredible story about God's faithfulness to their family. It's not too late to register for your free movie ticket. Guests, you are invited to dinner with the pastor on April the 18th at Maggiano's. Enjoy a complimentary Italian meal, lively conversation, and a time of question and answer with Dr. Jeffress. New members, we want to celebrate you becoming a part of our First Dallas family at our new member lunch on Sunday, April 21st. Following the 11 a.m. service, enjoy a free lunch and a time of fellowship with our pastor. If you've made a profession of faith and have not yet followed up with believers' baptism, participate in Baptism Sunday on April 28th, presided over by Dr. Jeffress. Sign up today on the concourse. For more information on everything happening at our church, visit firstdallas.org/events.
Hi, iCampus viewers. I'm Robert Jeffress, pastor of First Baptist Church in Dallas. If you have made a profession of faith in Jesus Christ, but haven't yet followed that decision with believer's baptism, I want to specifically invite you to come to First Baptist Dallas and participate in our Baptism Sunday on Sunday, April 28th. This is the perfect opportunity to publicly profess your faith in Christ and be baptized the way the Bible commands, by immersion after your salvation. Following the conclusion of our 11 a.m. worship service, I will be presiding over this special baptism service. And then afterwards, you'll have the chance to visit with our staff members and enjoy a special time of food and fellowship. If you'd like to participate on Sunday, April 28th, visit firstdallas.org/baptismsunday and let us know that you're part of our iCampus community. We can't wait to host you, and I'm looking forward to getting to meet you personally.
Today's scripture reading comes from Ephesians chapter 4. As the pastor continues his series out of this great book, we'll be reading verses 29 through 32 as Paul gives great instructions, not just to the Ephesians, but for us in our daily life. I look at this, I think these are going to be bullet points that I put on the refrigerator or someplace I'll see often because it's such great instruction for us. We'll be reading from the New American Standard Bible. Those will be the words on the screen in the worship center, and iCampus, you'll have them as well, so that we can all join together and read God's Word. And we invite you to stand to honor the reading of His Word. Ephesians chapter 4, beginning with verse 29, ending with verse 32. Let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth, but only such a word as is good for edification according to the need of the moment, so that it will give grace to those who hear. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ also has forgiven you. And may God richly reward the reading of his word. You may be seated at this time. You may be able to tell this is a special morning. You know, every Sunday is special here, but it's extra special today. We're excited to have with us today one of the most respected and decorated duos in Christian music, For King and Country. Brothers Joel and Luke Smallbone have won 4 Grammy Awards, 10 GMA Dove Awards, a Billboard Music Award, 13 K-Love Fan Awards, and their 9 number one hit songs have produced an astonishing accumulation of over 1 billion on-demand streams. It is amazing. Now, a little bit later in the service, they're going to be joined by their sister. These brothers and sister will be singing for us in just a bit. We're talking about Rebecca St. James. She's our first Dallas artist in residence. And yes, she has had 9 number one singles as well and sold nearly 2 million albums. She'll be coming out a little bit later on. But for right now, let's welcome For King and Country.
Well, top of the morning to you, First Baptist Dallas. Lovely to be back with you.
Stand face to face with a younger me. No, yeah. All of the mistakes, all of the heartbreak, here's what I do differently.
If you're with us, let me hear you give a cheer. Come on.
I love like a musket. Give when it's not fair. Give life for another. Take time for
travel is hard to walk.
Everybody knows it.
It takes a soldier who knows his orders to walk the walk I'm supposed to walk.
Give life
place. I'll fix my eyes. Thank you kindly. Choir, you sound lovely. Well done. Orchestra, band, give them a cheer if you would. It's a very rare occasion that we get to be with you. You guys can have a seat. Well, as was mentioned earlier, we are so thrilled not only to be with you, to sing for you this morning, but also to share with you about the definition of a passion project. It's a feature film that releases in theaters throughout the United States on the 26th of April, so a week and a half from now, which circles around our mom and our dad and your very own Rebecca St. James and her story, our sister. April 26th is also our parents' 49th wedding anniversary, everyone. So Rebecca, or Beck as I call her, her and I will be here this evening for the screening in this very room at 5:30, so come one, come all. We'd love to show you the film. But before we go any further, I'd like to know, are there any mums in the audience? Any mums? There you are. You are our unsung heroes this morning, mums. Or moms. How do you say it? You sound like a herd of sheep. So lovely. We sing this for every mum in the audience. The film circles around mums and miracles and family. If you're with your mum, hold her hand and give her a kiss on the cheek. Tell her that you love her. This is Unsung Hero. We're going to sit with you as well.
Once upon a time, you were 25, walking up the aisle. You made the promise of your life. You blinked twice and you were 29, singing lullabies. And I looked up at you for the first time. Words for sure, but I am sure there'll never be anyone like you. You're strong like your father, even when you were scared. And when I was in trouble, you never left me there. And you love like your mother. There's nothing to lose. You're my unsung hero, so I'll sing this song for you. Woke up, I was 21, and I fell in love. Remember how I told you that I'd searched the world, yet I found, thank God. Reminds me of you. You're strong like your father, even when you were scared. When I was in trouble, you never left me there. And you love like your mother, like there's nothing to lose. You're an unsung hero, and I'll sing this song for you. Times I fell down, you showed me how to stand. And when we crossed the ocean, you were my safe place to land. Been on a thousand stages, but when it's all said and done, oh, I hope I make you proud of the man that I've become. To be strong like my father, even when I'm scared. And when someone's in trouble, oh, I never leave them there. And I love like my mother,
like there's nothing to lose. You're our unsung heroes, and we sing this song for you.
Thank you, Connie. We'll see you tonight. And I've often asked myself, Luke, why do you keep singing this hymn around the house? And I think the truth is, we need to be reminded of the truth sometimes that we sing, even if it's just around the house. So sing this song with me.
I surrender all. I surrender all. To thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Let's sing that together once again.
I surrender all. And I surrender all. And all to thee, my blessed Savior. Savior, I surrender.
Let's stand together and sing that.
And I surrender all.
Just your voices all together. Here we go.
Be seated. In just a moment, King and Country and our choir and orchestra will be back for a song before today's message. But before we enter into our morning prayer time, I wanted to say a word about what happened yesterday. Yesterday, we witnessed something historic, the first time in modern history that Iran has directly attacked the nation of Israel. And I want to just offer a word of perspective about that. You know, Winston Churchill once said, this is not the end. This isn't the beginning of the end. But it is perhaps the end of the beginning. And I think perhaps that's what we are seeing right now. This is just the latest chapter in a story that's been going on for 4,000 years. 4,000 years ago, God said to Abraham, I'm going to make you a father of a great nation. It's a nation that's going to be a demonstration of my holiness, my justice, my love, my power. Your nation will endure forever. Those who bless you will be blessed by me. Those who curse you will be cursed by me. And ever since God made that promise to Abraham and his descendants, Satan has tried to prove that God can't keep his promise. Satan has been using human leaders like Pharaoh, Herod, Antiochus, Epiphanes, Adolf Hitler, to try to destroy this nation that God had promised. And they've been unsuccessful. Nations have been unsuccessful. Iran will be unsuccessful. They are not going to win. And the way I know this is what God said in Zechariah 2, verse 8. when I had the privilege of leading the dedicatory prayer for the opening of our embassy in Jerusalem in 2018, I quoted Zechariah 2:8, in which God said, "He has sent me and set me against those nations which plunder you, for he who touches you touches the apple of my eye." You don't touch the apple of God's eye without consequence. And that is why I say today to the many friends we have in Israel who watch our church every Sunday, who watch Pathway to Victory, I want you to know, as our Jewish friends, First Baptist Church Dallas is standing with you, and more importantly, God Himself is standing with you. You will not be defeated. We love you, Israel. We'll stand with you, and you will be victorious. Now, I'm going to ask all of our people who can to kneel. We're going to have a special prayer for Israel and for the remainder of our service today. By the way, our good friend Mike Evans, who is a friend of Bibi Netanyahu, a friend of Israel, he is leaving here, and my understanding is you're going to Israel and offer help and assistance, and we're praying for you, Mike, as you do that. Ben LaVorne is our executive pastor. He's going to come now and offer our prayer.
Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you now in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and in recognition of what's happening in our world today. We know that these attacks, these wars, these rumors of wars against your chosen people, the nation of Israel, are more than what meets the eye. These are demonically, satanically inspired attacks. They stem from battles that are raging in the spiritual realms. And so, Lord, we come before you, the Lord Almighty, and we ask for you to intercede in your unmatched power and might, that you would turn back your enemies, that you would overcome them in power, that you would gain a great victory, and that you, Lord, will be glorified as you preserve your people, as you are true to your promise to preserve them for all time. Lord, you have said that those who bless the nation of Israel, you will bless, that those who curse them, you will curse. So we pray here at First Baptist Dallas that we would always be counted among those who bless and stand with your people. We pray that you would give us leaders in our nation who would have the wisdom and strength to do the same. And Lord, as your church this morning, we pray that we would not be blind to the fact that we are embroiled in a very similar battle. And though our struggle is not against flesh and blood, we are battling against the forces of darkness in the heavenly realms, Lord. We are engaged in spiritual warfare. And so we pray that even today, as we worship you, as we hear a message from your word, that you would equip your saints for the work of your ministry through your Holy Spirit, and that we would go out from this place today as forces of light in the world, committed to fulfilling the mission that you have given us, to proclaiming your truth and to sharing your love through Jesus Christ. And we pray this all in the saving name of Jesus. Amen.
Stand together as we welcome back our resident artist, Rebecca St. James.
Such a joy to be with my First Dallas family and my little big brothers, Joel and Luke. Let's celebrate Jesus this morning. Sing along with us.
Blessed are the poor in spirit, who long for you. Blessed are the heavy heart, in need of you. Your hands are healing, your heart
God is hope. Your word is freedom for all of the world. You are redemption. You are our help. We need you with us.
Sing with us.
Let your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let your kingdom come and your will be done from now until forever. We'll keep on singing.
Your hands are healing, your heart is hope, your word is freedom for all of the world. You are redemption, you are our help.
Here it is.
We need you, Jesus.
Amen.
So let your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let your kingdom come and your will be done.
With humble heart, we're kneeling down. No other name, no other way. Lord, hear us as we pray.
Right here, right now, we're reaching out. With humble hearts, we're kneeling down. No other name, no other way. Lord, hear us as we pray. Let your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let your kingdom come and your will be done from now until forever. We'll keep on singing. Oh, let's start with us. Oh, your kingdom come.
Thank you for King and Country for your great music today. Didn't you enjoy that? And I hope you'll take the opportunity to be here this afternoon for an interview with them and a screening of their new movie, Unsung Heroes. It's going to be a great afternoon. We'll look forward to seeing you at 5:30 this afternoon. My friend Bob Beal tells a story about the time he decided just for fun to spend a day working at the circus. And during a break, he went over to where they kept the elephants. And he was amazed when he saw these giant animals being held in place by a flimsy chain on their ankle tied to a little stake in the ground. And so Bob asked the elephant trainer, "Hi, how is it that you're able to stake down this animal weighing thousands of pounds with a tiny stake and chain?" And he said, "Well, it's easy when you remember two things about elephants. Number one, they're not very smart. But number two, they have great memories. And when these elephants are little babies, only 400 pounds, We stake them down with that chain and stake, and they may try 10,000 times to get free, and they're unable to do so. That's when their memory takes over. And even though they could easily break loose if they wanted to, they've given up even trying to do so. You know, that's a great analogy for how many Christians live today. They remember what life was like before Christ when they tried and tried and tried to say no to sin and were unsuccessful. And even though now they have the power of the Holy Spirit of God within them, they don't even try to live in victory. What a shame. Paul says in Romans 6, 6 and 7, "Know this, that our old self was crucified with Christ in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin. For he who has died is free from sin." Ladies and gentlemen, when you become a Christian, the power of the Holy Spirit is in you. Sin has no more power over you than you choose to allow it to have. Yes, we have that old sin nature still in us, but once we become a Christian, it's been crucified. It's not been eradicated completely, but it's been rendered powerless. Its power has been destroyed over you. You say, "Well, that's great, but what does that have to do with me?" I'm so glad you ask, because that truth ought to transform the way we live in an unholy world. Remember last time we saw in Ephesians 4, 22, Paul said, "In reference to your former manner of life, lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lust of deceit." We're to lay aside our old self. Remember that phrase, "lay aside," refers to the taking off of garments. We're to take off spiritual clothing, behavior that's not suitable for us now that we've been saved. We're to lay aside the clothing of the old self and put on the clothing of the new self. Think about Lazarus when Jesus raised him from the dead and he stumbled out of that tomb into the daylight. He had clothes on, grave clothes that were beginning to stink. Now, he could have kept them on for sentimental reasons. "I like these clothes," but no. He needed new clothes that were suitable for his new status. So it is with those of us who have been raised with Christ in a new way of living. We're to take off the old behavior and we're to put on new behavior. And that leads us in our study to verse 25 of Ephesians 4. I call this Paul's five fashion tips. In these verses, he's going to share with us five behaviors that we need to put aside forever and five behaviors we need to replace our old behavior with. Look at first of all, he says in verse 25, we need to take off false speech and put on truth. Now, this isn't heavy theology. This is getting down to where we live. We need to take off false speech and put on truth. Look at verse 25. "Therefore, laying aside falsehood, speak truth, each one of you with his neighbor, for we are members of one another." I read this week of a pastor who was walking out to his car, and he noticed on the parking lot a group of children, and they were having quite an animated discussion. And he walked up and said, "What are you all arguing about?" And one of the boys said, "Well, Mr., we found a puppy, and we all want the puppy, so we decided to determine who got the puppy. We would have a contest and see who could tell the biggest lie. Whoever tells the biggest lie gets the puppy." And the pastor summoned all his righteous indignation and said, "I can't imagine you would do such a thing. Why, I never told a lie when I was a boy like you." The boys looked at each other, started to fidget, and finally one of them said, "Okay, mister, you get the puppy." I mean, the fact is, we all lie, don't we? In their book, The Day America Told the Truth, researchers James Peterson and Peter Kim researched the morality of everyday Americans, and they did a survey of 2,000 Americans to see how they really behaved. And in the chapter, American Liars, they said something that really caught my attention. They wrote, "Just about everyone lies. 91% of us lie regularly. The majority of us find it hard to get through a week without lying. One in five can't make it through a single day, and we're talking about conscious, premeditated lies. Now, you may be saying, well, that's not me, Pastor. I don't lie. Before you say that too quickly, think about the various ways we do lie. He says, let all falsehoods be put aside. That word is pseudos in Greek. It doesn't mean just out-and-out whoppers we tell. There are various ways we tell falsehoods. For example, through exaggeration. We Texans are prone to do that, trying to stretch the truth to make a good story even better. One estimate says 60% of all resumes contain exaggeration of experience or educational degrees. Exaggeration is a way of telling a falsehood. A second way we speak falsely is through flattery. You know, we flatter people in order to serve our own agenda. I can't remember where I read it, but somebody's talked about the difference between gossip and flattery. They said gossip is saying something behind somebody's back you would never say to their face, while flattery is saying something to somebody's face you would never say about behind their back. Proverbs 29:5 says, a man who flatters his neighbor is spreading a net for his own steps. A third way we speak falsehood is by what we don't say, silence. Silence. Whenever you're in a group or talking with an individual and they make a claim that you know is false, especially if it's a criticism of somebody else or an accusation, you know it's false. But to remain silent is to engage in falsehood. A friend of mine says to stand by and do nothing in the face of evil is to do something. It's to approve of evil. To say nothing in the face of lies is to say something to approve of lies. Why are we not to speak falsehood? I want you to notice in this verse, verse 25, an implicit and an explicit reason we're not to lie. The implicit reason is found in that word, falsehood, pseudos. Literally, that word means the lie, the lie. Who is it that is known as the liar of all lies? Satan himself. John 8:44 says, Satan is a liar. He is the father of all lies. And when we as Christians engage in any kind of deception, any kind of falsehood, we are acting more like a child of Satan's than a child of God. But there's an explicit reason given here that we're not to lie. In verse 25, it says, for we are members of one another. We're a part of the same body, the body of Christ. And for the body to be healthy, it has to operate in truth. Think about your physical body. What if one day your kidneys woke up and said, you know, we feel neglected. We want to gain some attention. So we're going to send a message to the brain that we're in bad shape, even though we're doing well. We're going to send some false information to the brain. Or say your liver is very proud and is suffering an illness, and it should tell the brain the truth, but it doesn't want to admit it has a problem, so it makes itself look better than it really is. You'd have a catastrophe in your body. Your body depends upon truth being relayed one member to another. So it is in the body of Christ. We're to lay aside falsehood. Secondly, we need to take off uncontrolled anger and put on patience. Verse 26 says, be angry and yet do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. That verse has always been interesting to me. Is it wrong to be angry? Is it wrong to be angry? It depends. It depends. It depends what you do with that anger. He says, be angry and yet do not sin. You know, there's no verse in Scripture that says, be lustful, but don't sin. Be drunk, but don't sin. Be a thief, but don't sin. But it does say, be angry, and yet do not sin. You know why Paul says that? Because anger is a natural emotion. Remember the definition I gave in our Solomon Secret series? I said, anger is a physical and emotional response to perceived injustice. When we see some injustice, whether it's against others or against ourselves being committed, we get angry. Do you know why we get angry? Because we're made in the image of a God who gets angry. We are made in God's image, and God gets angry. Hundreds of times in Scripture, there are references to the anger, the wrath of God. And so we naturally have a predisposition to anger, but it's what we do with this anger that matters, how we handle it. You won't see this in the English text, but in this entire section, there are three different words that are translated anger or angry. One is thumos, thumos. It's the word used at the end of verse 26 or end of verse 31. Let all anger be put away. That's explosive anger, the Mount Vesuvius kind of eruption that you have when you get angry. He says, put that away, thumos. Another word is paragismos. It refers to an embittered anger, a seething inside. That is the word that is used in verse 26. But then there is a word at the beginning of verse 26, orge, which refers to a general kind of anger that can erupt into a thumos, a violent expression, or into a bitterness, paragismos. Be angry and yet do not sin. The point is, when we get angry, we need to deal with it and deal with it in a correct way. Don't let anybody fool you. Anger suppressed, if we hold it in but don't deal with it, anger suppressed is just as deadly as anger expressed. If we have a violent eruption, we need to apologize for it. If we have bitterness, we need to figure out how we can remove that bitterness. But notice what he says in verse 26 and 27, don't let the sun go down on your anger, and don't give the devil an opportunity. If you feel that anger, deal with it before the day is out, and certainly don't go to bed angry. Somebody said, he who goes to sleep angry has the devil as a bed partner. I like what Phyllis Diller, remember Phyllis Diller, the late comedian, she said, don't go to bed angry, stay up and fight. Well, for those of you who are married, I might tweak that a little bit. Don't go to bed angry, stay up and resolve the issue, Paul says. Be angry and yet do not sin. There's a third behavior we need to take off. We need to take off theft and put on diligence. Take off theft and put on diligence. Notice what he says in verse 28. He who steals must steal no longer, but rather let him labor, performing with his own hands what is good, so that he will have something to share with one who has need. Remember, when Paul wrote these words, one-third of the world was slave. One-third of the world were slaves. And slaves, even Christian slaves, sometimes practice theft. They figured, I'm not being treated justly, and therefore I'm going to take some of what my master has. He said, no, don't do that. He who steals must steal no longer, but rather he must labor. Now, again, you may be thinking, well, this is one of those things I don't have to worry about. I would never steal anything. Think again. Have you ever padded an expense report at work? Have you ever underreported your income to the government? I'm reminded of the story of a letter, an anonymous letter the IRS received one day. The letter said, "Dear sirs, I found myself unable to sleep at night over the taxes that I owe. Enclosed, find a check for $500. If I still can't sleep, I'll send the rest of what I owe." I mean, that is theft. Plagiarism. Taking somebody else's work, a paper, a sermon, and preaching it word for word or writing it word for word as your own, that's theft. Employers, if you're not paying a fair wage to your employees, that's theft. Employees, if you're not putting a full day's work in for what you're receiving in salary, that is stealing from your employer. I once read of the founder of a major insurance company who had an employee who was on the way to become president of the company. But the founder found out that this up-and-coming executive was actually taking paper clips home from the office to stock his private office at home. And when the founder found out about it, he fired the executive. The executive was so incensed by that, what he thought, overreaction, that he quit after he was fired and went and founded his own rival insurance company. Within 3 years, the company went bankrupt when it was discovered he had falsified records. When the founder was asked about what his ex-employee had done, he said simply this: honesty begins with paper clips. The Bible says we shouldn't steal in any way. What's the antidote to stealing? It's working, learning to work. We live in an age in which people want to get something for nothing, but that doesn't work in the real world, does it? We need to work. The rabbis used to have a saying, if you don't teach your child a trade, you teach them to become a thief. We need to teach our children and our grandchildren to work hard. One antidote to theft is labor. The other is generosity. He must labor, performing with his own deeds, hands what is good, so that he will have something to share with one who has need. We ought to teach our children to work, not just so they could hoard money for themselves, but that they might become generous in sharing with others. There's a fourth behavior we need to take off. Look at verses 29 to 30. We need to take off unwholesome speech and put on edifying speech. Look at this in verse 29. Let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth, but only such a word as is good for edification, according to the needs of the moment, that it might give grace to those who hear. Unwholesome. The Greek word for unwholesome refers to a piece of rotting fruit. Don't speak anything that is going to contaminate people around you. You know the old adage, rotten apple spoils the whole barrel. Don't say things that cause contamination, that cause other people to rot spiritually. Let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth. What is he talking about specifically? Obviously, I think he's talking about crude speech, off color, coarse jesting. In fact, he'll talk about that more, so we won't belabor that. Crude speech, but I think he's also talking about critical speech, speech that tears down another person. Because the way I know he's referring to that is what he says is the antidote. Instead, speak only a word that is good for edification. That word, oikodomia, means to build up somebody else. You know, all of us have people in our lives that we are responsible for correcting if they do something wrong. Parents have a responsibility to correct their children. Employers have a responsibility to correct their employees. Wives have a responsibility to correct their husbands. Well, they do it anyway. And we do it anyway, unfortunately. But the point is, if you have to correct somebody, do it in a way that builds them up, not in a way that tears them down. If you have to correct somebody, make sure you find something to praise them for. You know, our executive pastor, Ben LeBourne, is very good about that. He gets the job of correcting the staff. But I've heard from others that he's talked to that he does it in a kind way, in a constructive way, and he builds them up, praises them for the good things they're doing first. We need to do that as well. Isn't it interesting, the next verse that comes after that, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Isn't that interesting? Why would he put that verse here? Because I'm convinced that nothing grieves the Holy Spirit of God anymore. than when we tear down, discourage those whom God has made in his own image. To criticize, to tear down somebody is to destroy the spirit of somebody God has made. We need to take off unwholesome speech and put on edifying speech. And then finally, notice what he says in verses 31 to 32. We need to take off unresolved bitterness and put on forgiveness. Verse 31, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you along with all malice. Have you ever heard somebody say, you can't tell what's in a person's heart? Have you ever heard that before? That's not true. Many times you can tell what's in a person's heart. Think of it this way. If you're carrying around a mug and somebody bumps into you, whatever spills out of that mug reveals what's in the mug. If it's coffee, they'll get stained with coffee. If it's orange juice, they'll get stained with orange juice. But you can tell what's in that person's mug, even though you can't see what's in it, by what spills out of it. It's the same way with our lives. If our lives are filled with unforgiveness, bitterness, when people hurt us, they bump into us intentionally or unintentionally, what spills out of our mouth is what reveals what is in our heart. And when somebody is constantly speaking words of wrath and anger and clamor and slander, it reveals what is in their heart. And what is in their heart, most of the time, is unresolved bitterness, unforgiveness. Have you discovered this? All of us are going to be hurt in life by somebody. We don't have any choice over that. We don't have a choice of what other people do to us, but we do have a choice of how we respond to those wrongs. We can hold them in until they metastasize into a tumor of bitterness, or we can choose to release that hurt, let go of it, let God take care of settling the score. And if we refuse to forgive, we'll find our speech being filled with slander, bitterness, and wrath. No, we need to take off unresolved bitterness and put on forgiveness. You say, well, why should I do that? Why in the world should I let go of a hurt somebody's committed against me? He explains in verse 32, be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ has forgiven you. The reason we forgive other people is not because they deserve to be forgiven, or they ask to be forgiven, or they even know they need to be forgiven. We forgive because of what God has done for us. If you've accepted God's forgiveness in your life, then you have the obligation to forgive those who wrong you. Forgiving each other just as God in Christ has also forgiven you. C.S. Lewis said, to be a Christian means to forgive the inexcusable in others because God has forgiven the inexcusable in us. I love the words, when we forgive, we set the prisoner free. And the prisoner we set free is us. Let's bow together in a word of prayer. We've dealt with a lot of material today, but on this last point of forgiveness, maybe as I begin talking about it, God brought to your mind a face of somebody who has hurt you and hurt you deeply, somebody you need to forgive. If you find it impossible to let go, to let God deal with that situation, if you find your heart filled with anger and resentment and a desire for vengeance, it may be because you've never truly received God's forgiveness in your life. To admit to God that you've done the inexcusable, that you deserve God's punishment, but you're trusting in God to forgive you because of what Christ has done for you. If you've never received forgiveness from God. You can't extend that forgiveness to other people. For some of you, the most important thing you could do today would be to admit to God your need for forgiveness and to ask Him to forgive you based on what Christ has done for you. Today, if you would like to receive that gift of forgiveness, I encourage you to pray this prayer in your heart as I prayed out loud, knowing that God is listening to you. Dear God, thank you for loving me. I know that I have failed you in so many ways, and I'm truly sorry for the sins in my life. But I believe what I've heard today, that you loved me so much you sent your son Jesus to die on the cross for me, to take the punishment I deserve to take. And right now I'm trusting in what Jesus did for me, not in my good works, but in what Jesus did for me to save me from my sins. Thank you for forgiving me and help me to live the rest of my life for you. In Jesus' name, amen. For those of you watching on our iCampus, if you prayed that prayer and you really meant it, go up to the top of the screen, click on the link that says, I prayed the prayer to trust in Christ. We'll be notified of your decision. We have some free material to send you about what it means to live your life as a Christian. I'm going to ask those of you in day one and in our worship center to take this card right now that is in your bulletin, and you'll notice that there's a place for you to check the second box at the bottom if you prayed this prayer with me. We want to get in contact with you and send you that free material as well. Maybe you'd like to join First Baptist Dallas, as so many did last week. All you have to do is check this box. We'll call you this week and process your membership information. Also, we would like to invite you this Thursday night to dinner with the pastor. If you're a guest and would like to know more about First Baptist Dallas, I want to treat you to dinner Thursday night at Maggiano's at North Park. It's at 7 o'clock, and we'll have a great meal and a time of fun and information and answer your questions about First Baptist Dallas. Just check that box, and we'll give you all the information this week. And if you're a guest, certainly we want to know that you're here. Check that box, I'm a guest, on the way out. If you drop the card off to your at the Welcome Center, we'll exchange your completed card for a copy of my brand new book, The Not All Roads Lead to Heaven Daily Devotional. And it's our gift to you for coming to First Baptist Dallas. Thanks so much for doing that. Let me just say, 2 weeks from today, on April 28th, we're having what we call Baptism Sunday at First Baptist Dallas. And if you've never been scripturally baptized, that means by immersion after you became a Christian. Not as a little six-month-old, but after you become a Christian. That's the biblical pattern. Believe first and then be baptized. If you would like to have believer's baptism, we're going to have a special service to baptize you right after our 11 o'clock service on Sunday, April 28th. I believe they have a link to go to firstdallas.org/baptismsunday. Go to that and you can register to be baptized on Sunday, April 28th. Didn't you enjoy Rebecca St. James and King and Country today? We want to say thank you to them. And again, remind you to be here this afternoon for the interview with For King and Country and then the premiere of their movie, Unsung Heroes. And we'll look forward to that tonight at 5 o'clock. Tyler, you come and lead us in our final song.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Pastor. Let's stand together, church, as we close together singing God's praise. This is my story.
This is my story.
Oh,
God bless you, church.
Hello, I'm Emmanuel Pandula, but you can call me Manny, your iCampus pastor. Thanks for joining us for worship. I hope you feel uplifted and encouraged after today's service. Continue to spread the joy by inviting your loved ones to join us every week and stay connected on our social media platforms and iCampus Global Facebook group, where you'll find inspiring content, updates, and connect with believers worldwide. Also, join our iCampus community for a Sunday school lesson taught by Ryland Whitehorn, our executive pastor of ministries, at 8:30, 9:15, and 11 a.m. Central Time. I look forward to personally getting to know you, so be sure to leave a message in the chat about how I can pray and minister to you. Remember, we're here to serve you every Sunday morning and throughout the week in your spiritual walk. Stay blessed and see you soon.